part of what makes us worry about the future, part of what makes us frustrated with the future is thinking we have so much to do, so many things to plan, so much that we have to get right. If we don't get the grades right and the timing right, and if we don't meet the right people, and we don't pick the right job and get our resume right, and if we don't do all that, then we're going to wreck our future. Might I tell you that that's actually quite arrogant. That's quite prideful to think that you know what's going to happen in the future. All right, let's read this thing from Marin. I'm struggling with everything that is happening in my life. Have cancer, but God has blessed me with that being not gone, but at the very least under control for a sustained long time. But at the same time, I'm struggling with my classwork and future direction. Started wondering if being healed was more of a sick joke than a blessing, with all the trouble I have just figuring out a path forward through the last part of college and then out into the working world. Hope all that made sense. Well, Marin, that's rough. I mean, having cancer, it's a big word. Going into remission is great, but it's not like you're cured, it's all gone. You know, it's in remission, and so that's always kind of hanging over your head, producing that little bit of anxiety that you know, it's like, when's it going to come back? Is it going to come back? You know, because you've been through some treatment already, and it's, you know, that was scary. Now you've got school sitting in front of you, and that's got all the social pressure. It's got the class pressure. It's got the, you know, get your grades pressure. Plus there's financial pressure on top of that, because you've got money stuff happening. Plus you've got, you know, like relational things happening in your life, I have no doubt. Then you've got to choose, you know, a path forward. You've got the end of college coming, which is a huge life transition. You go from, you know, one set of friends to a different set of friends, one place to another place, school to a job, you know, almost adulthood to adulthood. And so you got this another transition coming. So it's a lot for a person to handle. I think the first thing I would tell you is cut yourself a little bit of slack, because you should be feeling a lot, right? That anybody in the world who's facing what you're facing, going through what you're going through, and walking through all these things, would be just as stressed out, worried, frustrated. As a Christian, one of the things that we do is we recognize that, you know, in this world we will have trouble. There is a lot going on. Like Paul struggled, and Jesus, he cried and he was frustrated and he was scared and he got, you know, there was a lot in his life that caused him to not only weep but also get mad. He was left alone. Jesus felt the full weight of human emotion. We have all sorts of examples of people that are good, wonderful, godly people, but you know, they were stressed out, man. There was a lot going on in their life, and what did they do with it? Well, some people turned to sin and flipped out, and some people turned to God and just sought him and his strength and just trusted him with it. Like I think of David, who, you know, he faced a ton of stress. He was promised good things at the beginning. Then he went through a big trial in the middle. He had people, the king chasing him down, and he had all sorts of crazy stuff happening. People wanted him dead. He all of a sudden he was in charge of a bunch of people that he didn't think he was ever going to be in charge of, and they're starving, and you know, like he's got all this pressure, and he takes that pressure, and he has a choice, right? Because he's got a temptation. He's like, I could murder the king. I could go and you know, take what I want because now I have an army and I've got skill, or I can trust God. And you can see all the way through the Psalms, especially the Psalms of Lament, where he's like, why are the rich people doing so much better? Why are the wicked so much better off? Why are people who don't deserve to be healthy and happy so healthy and happy? It doesn't make sense to me, God. And then he turns that over to God. And at the end, he basically says, I don't have an answer, but I will say this, I will trust you, and I know from the history of Israel and from my own life that despite of how hard it is, you'll take me through, right? He thinks back to when the lion and the bear comes and tries to eat his flock, and he's like, that was scary, you brought me through it. When he was standing before you know, Saul, and Saul's trying to put armor on him before he's going to go fight Goliath. And he's like, no, I can't do that. I can't wear it. And he goes out armorless, holding a slingshot. He's like, that was scary, but God brought me through it. And then he continues on. And so throughout his life, he faces these huge things, and he goes, it was scary. There was a lot going on, but I trusted you and I got through. One thing that we see throughout scripture, especially when it comes to stressed out times, is that we're not meant to do it alone. We're meant to do it in community. It's when we get depressed and anxious and frustrated and angry and that drives us away from people that we get in trouble, right? We start thinking things like, because I'm such a troublemaker, because I've got so many bad things happening to me, I infect other people with my negativity. I've got so much frustrating stuff in my life that whenever I talk to somebody, I'm just a downer. I should stop talking to people. Whenever I go to church and people ask me how I'm doing, I always have to say, you know, I'm going through a bad time again. And they go, still? And it's really embarrassing. And so maybe I should stop telling people. The enemy starts putting into our heads that we should stop hanging around people, stop telling people our problems, stop connecting with them, stop sharing our heart. And we should be alone, and we should be afraid, and we should be in the dark because we're protecting people. That's a deception. It's meant to get you alone so he can beat you up, right? He's a coward by nature, and therefore when there's more people around and there's more believers around, he's too scared to enter into that. So he wants to be like a lion that pulls you away from the flock, or pulls you away from the herd so that he can chew on you. Don't leave the herd. Right? Don't leave the herd. So like I look at your list there, right? I'm struggling with everything that's happening in my life. That's pressure from the inside. You have to let that out. You need to find a trusted mentor, a trusted Christian, older woman, a pastor, somebody that's in your life, a Christian friend that you can just dump all this stuff on that you know isn't going to try to solve all your problems. They're just going to listen. You know, you say, I have cancer, God healed me. You praise God for that. But at the same time, you go, you know what, I've also got these other struggles, God, I need, and what I see is, you know, I need future direction. I don't know what's going to happen in the working world. I don't know how I'm going to get through classes. Every day is a struggle, but so is the future. That's where you can come to somebody and say, can you help me pray for direction? Can you help me seek wisdom? Can you help me find rest? Can you, you know, I'm hungry. I don't cook well for myself, or I'm sleepy. I don't sleep well. Can you help me with that? I'm laying myself out before you to say, I can't do this alone. I need some help. That's where God brings in community to take some of those burdens away. God commands the church. God commands other Christians to bear your burdens, right? God commands other Christians to enter into your life and walk with you. He commands the spiritual, the ones who are feeling pretty good, the ones who are connected to God better than you, to come into your life and actually help you walk with God, help serve you, give to you, be generous with you, and help you find direction and hope, and also to do practical things like make sure you're taken care of. Don't get alone. It's such a temptation to pull inward. You need to step out. You need to make sure you go to somebody, that you talk to them. And it's okay if that person is in Discord. It's okay if that person is in chat, like you just did with me, right? It's okay if that person is an email that they're far away through video chat or something like that. It doesn't have to be a face-to-face person if that's not what you have right now. You can talk to somebody virtually, and it works too. Sure, I'd love it if you had that perfect person in front of you that was able to sit there and, you know, meet your needs right away. But there are a lot of virtual places that you can go. And so I'm hoping for you that as the enemy tries to pull you away from God, pull you, the little lamb, away from and get you lost in the woods, that you'll recognize that God is the one who comes to get you. But at the same time, wandering away will get you in trouble. Okay, so quiz has a good point. So let me just ask the question, right? I'll just say, if you're in chat right now and you are going through a tough time, whether it be a struggle physically or medically, or you're confused about life in some way, put a note in chat. just say it. Say, me too. Or say, yep, I'm there. Because one of the things that the enemy's going to tell you, Marin, is that no one else is going through stuff, right? Quiz stands up, and he's the first one in chat. He's like, you know what? Me too. I have been going through struggle in work, and it's stressing me out. You're not the only one. He is too. So I personally, I'm feeling it. Like the Dragonheart, struggling hard right now. I'm feeling it too. Like I've got stuff in my life. I've got stuff in my relationships. I've got stuff financially. I've got a ton of uncertainty in front of me. Every day I wake up, I don't know what's going to happen. I live in an almost constant state of crisis, and I've got all these responsibilities and people that are counting on me, and it's really scary. It's really scary. I want to you know, dive into bed and never come out. But it's God every day shows up. As long as I show up, he shows up. As long as I ask, he's always there. As long as I wake up, he's still with me, and he sustains me. And I'm always wondering miraculously how it's possible that I'm able to go for one more day, because he's there and he's been doing it. Ukulele. Takuya says, yep, struggling. Ukulele says, yep, struggle knowing the future of my career, aging family, constant home repairs. Woody says, struggling with social anxiety really bad to the point that I'm just sheltering myself at home. That's tough, right? I know that one. For 6 months, 6 months, 6 months, I didn't go to church. I was too scared. I stayed in the house. I tried to work myself up to going. It was too scary. I couldn't make myself. And when I went there and I finally got there, I had panic attacks every week for like 6 weeks. It's terrifying. The social anxiety that because of abuse, because of PTSD, because of all the stuff, caused me just no end of misery. And it, you know, because of my job and I was a pastor and local pastor, all the relationships in my life, when as soon as I stopped being a pastor and started this, I lost like 99% of them. They're gone. So yeah, loneliness is real. But that's why we have each other, right? I mean, the magic of Twitch, the beauty of Twitch, of live streaming, is that you can sit here and you can say, hey, I'm going through a tough time, and some person live can chat. And there are people that are watching right now that they can enter into chat too. And we can talk, and we can pray, and we can love, we can entertain each other. We can have just a time together. Woody doesn't have to feel alone because he can be in his cocoon, you know, like I'm in my cocoon, but we can hang out together. We can enjoy things together. We can share together and be a community. I love that. This is the best thing about Twitch, is building that meaningful community that actually cares about one another. And I know for a fact that Dragon cares about me, and I care about him. Ukulele, Takuya, we care about each other, right? Quiz, we're gonna, like, literally, there are people, and this honestly blew my mind. I've been invited down to Florida for a 4-day conference so I can come and talk about streaming stuff, streaming ministry, right? And all of a sudden, you know, Ukulele said, hey, I'm pretty close to there. Maybe we should go for dinner. And then another person said, hey, I'm pretty close to there. Can I come? And then someone else is like, I'm not close to there, but I'm going to drive. Quiz is driving like 9 hours to come and have dinner and hang out. And we're putting something up on the Discord soon to be able to say, this is where we're going to be. And we're going to hang out. We're going to have tacos because that's the most appropriate thing to eat. And we're going to be doing some fun game stuff. But it blew my mind that the people that are in chat that we've been talking and hanging out with and I've been with not only care about me here, but are willing to do sacrificial, loving things to be with me when I come there, because they really do like me. And that's... it's so crazy. It's so crazy to me that there are people out there that care about me that much, that they would come out to see me and put, you know, gas and time, take time off work just so they can hang out. It means so much. It means so much. And so that to say, like with Woody and with Marin and whatnot, these relationships are real. Don't discount them. They're real. And give yourself some credit for showing up to stream, showing up to the Discord, showing up and just kind of and giving sharing your heart, right? Marin, can I pray for you? Would that be I'm gonna anyway, whether you want me to or not, but let's pray for Marin. Because she asked for it. God, thank you for your incredible love for us, that you are the God who seeks us when we have wandered away. You leave the 99 to find the one. You are the son to the father to the prodigal son, who waits and looks and is eagerly anticipating us coming back and blows the doors off grace when we walk through the door. You are the one who has the host of heaven burst into song when someone repents, when someone turns to you. You're the one who, well on the cross, was forgiving someone and promising eternity to someone hanging next to them who had never done anything to earn it. You are the God of grace. And you're also the God of the future. You promise that you have it well in hand. And if we trust you, we seek first your kingdom, your righteousness, that you've got the rest. And we know that in this world we're going to have trouble. There's going to be persecution. There's going to be misery. There's going to be difficulty. We recognize that. But we also know that every single part of it, every tear, every problem, you see and can use for your grace, for your glory, for our good. We trust you. And while Marin is looking into the future, it's pretty hazy. Help her to recognize that she has enough worries today, that tomorrow will worry about itself, and that she's not responsible for the whole rest of her life. She's only responsible for the next right thing. Whatever that is, God, impress upon her your love, your grace, your patience, your peace, and for her to know that you are walking with her every step. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so Marin, here's something that helped me out, and I remembered it while I was praying, and that is your level of responsibility. Part of what makes us worry about the future, part of what makes us frustrated with the future is thinking we have so much to do, so many things to plan, so much that we have to get right. If we don't get the grades right and the timing right, and if we don't meet the right people, and we don't pick the right job and get our resume right, and if we don't do all that, then we're going to wreck our future. Might I tell you that that's actually quite arrogant. That's quite prideful to think that you know what's going to happen in the future. You don't. There's no chance in my life I would have told you I'd be standing here today. There's no chance that the day before I met my wife, I was going to tell you I had actually committed to a life of celibacy by myself the day before. There's no way that you would ever tell me that that a guy who was terrified to be up front would be... Thank you! Thank you. Yes, I will drug. That I would be a pastor or a preacher, because I was scared. I was too scared to stand up front. No step along the way. I've never gotten a job with a resume. I've had three different ministries in two different countries in, 40 hours away from each other and driving. I've never gotten a job with my resume, ever. God has directed my path. So the only thing... You are responsible. And Lady Gunn's right? God just worked. He just, despite how messed up we are, he still works things for good. The only thing you're responsible for, and I'll say this to Epic, and I'll say this to Dragon, I'll say this to Marin, and anybody else who's listening, the only thing you're responsible for right now is the next right thing. Just the next thing standing in front of you. That could be a nap. That could be a snack. That could be... Just, doing one thing, showing up to that one meeting. That could be cracking open your Bible. That could be calling a friend. That could be doing any number of things. But the only thing you're responsible for, the only thing you have control over is whatever the next right thing is. Because you don't know by the end of that hour what's going to happen. You could get a phone call. You won the lottery. You could get a phone call. Everybody you know died. You don't know. You don't know. The only thing you're responsible for is the next right thing. So sometimes the best thing you can do is simply say, I'm tired, I need a nap, God, take over from here. Right? Sometimes the best thing you can do is say, you know what, I need a walk. I have not been outside for a long time. I know that. I've been, so even though I feel like my house isn't clean, I have homework to do, I have responsibilities or whatever, I know for a fact that I need to go for a walk. You get up and you go for a walk. There's some times where it's like, you know what? I need to buckle down. I need to do that assignment. Yes, I've got 50 assignments, but I'm going to do one of them. That's all I'm going to do is one of them. That's all you're responsible for. The rest is up to God. You can't change the past. You can't change the future. All you have is the present, and therefore that's all you can work with. The stress comes from thinking you can control the future and that your mistakes or your good deeds are going to alter it. Might I suggest that you don't have that power? You just have the power over what's happening right now. My encouragement to you is this. Meditate on what you're feeling right now. Think about what you're feeling right now. The truth, are you believing lies, right? I'm a terrible person. Nobody likes me. Nothing will ever change. I should be worried all the time. Nobody can help me. Nobody understands, and nobody's ever gone through what I've gone through. Are you believing lies? Are you worried about stuff that you can't control? You know, you're sitting there, you're just chewing your fingernails, and you're so frustrated, and you're so upset about things out in the world. You know, I'm so angry at this country, and it's getting me all worked up. Well, you can't control that country. Your emotions are misplaced, right? There's nothing you can do about it. You got stuff locally that you need to worry about. So the question is it legitimate? That's what I want you. That is using your brain, your cognition, your logic. That's in the Bible, we talk about submitting every thought to Christ. The idea is that you hold that thought in the light of the truth, right? The enemy says to be afraid of the future. God says, I've got the future in my hands. The enemy says, everything's out of control and you need to freak out. God says, I've got it. I control the past, the present, and the future. I know every single detail. I've got it. You know, the enemy says you should pull yourself away from people because you're infectious. Your badness infects them. You should be alone. The Bible says, share your burdens with others, confess your sins to one another, bear one another's burdens, help each other, open up your heart, be real with people, and then they can walk with you, right? The enemy says, you should not be praying. God doesn't listen to your prayers. He's so sick of your nonsense, he doesn't listen anymore. The Bible says, he's always available. He will always listen. He's there right now, available to you. Right? The enemy says, keep going to that sin. Keep going, dipping into that garbage. Keep eating that crap because eventually it'll make you feel better, or it'll make you feel better for now. Don't worry about the future. The Bible says you're poisoning yourself. You're hurting yourself. God invites you to get well, to get help, to feel better, but in a way that is going to last and is going to make you a victor rather than a victim. Is the thought going through your head right now? Is it legit? Is it real? Nope, don't fall. Okay, good. Whoa, don't kill me. I've only got one life. One life to live.